These beautiful and unusual sculptures were created by a man in his early 20s, an outdoorsman, a hunter, a father, a man who ended his own life at the age of 31. I'm Mike Heikka. I'm here today at the National Cowboy Hall of Fame and Western Heritage Center in Oklahoma City. Earl Erik Heikka was my late father. He was a sculptor of the American West back in the 1930s. I'd like to tell you a little about his life and show you some of his works. These sculptures were among the first works put on display at the inception of the Hall of Fame back in 1967. They were purchased directly from Earl Heikka by Mr. C.R. Smith, a noted Western art collector and one of the founders of American Airlines. Mr. Smith gave the sculptures to his friend Red Mosier, who for reasons unknown to me had them painted dark gray. Upon Mr. Mosier's death, they were donated to the Hall of Fame. They are some of the very last sculptures Heikka made before his death in 1941 at the age of 31. These next two sculptures at the Hall of Fame are entitled Double Road Agents, a painted clay original, and Days of the Slow Gun, which is a multicolor patina bronze casting. Heikka was born on May the 3rd, 1910, in the small mining town of Belt, Montana, a small community about 50 miles or so east of Great Falls. Earl was born in the upstairs bedroom and was the youngest of a family of 10 children. He lost four of his brothers and sisters at birth. In those days, women would have their children at home rather than a hospital. Both Earl's mother and father came to the United States from the northern part of Finland in the late 1800s. They met and married in Wyoming and moved into Belt to establish their family. Earl's father set him up a liquor store saloon combination in the town of Belt and was fairly successful at it. Earl's brother Charles is on the left and his brother Michael is on the right. For reasons that I've yet to determine, Earl's father died at the age of 48, when Earl was only 6 years old. Upon the death of his father in 1916, Earl's mother sold the store and saloon and moved her family into Great Falls. Very shortly after this, Earl's brothers and sisters all moved away, with the exception of Mike, who remained with his mother. In about 1918, Earl moved from Great Falls, went off to live with his sister in Laurel, Montana. Very shortly after Laurel, they moved into Lewistown, where Earl began school. It was at this point that Earl began his modeling career. Lewistown had a natural clay quarry, and Earl would obtain modeling clay from this source. He began by making small animals and little Indians that would be used as toys by his young nephews, and learned to develop his techniques. He'd set himself up a studio in the basement. When Earl was about 15, he moved from his sister's home in Lewistown back into Great Falls, where he lived with his mother for a short period of time. He was very much an outdoorsman, and he did a lot of bear hunting and deer and elk and so on. He also did a lot of fishing. he became quite proficient at the bow and arrow to the degree where he could hunt rabbit with it. In 1933, Earl married Virginia Middleton, my mother. They went on to have four children. I'm the youngest son. Earl and Virginia had a studio home built out Route 2 South, just a little, about 10 miles south of Great Falls. It's quite interesting that Earl had the logs for this studio pre-assembled in the mountains. He made a deal with a logger, and they cut all the logs down, and he approved them, and they numbered them. He hauled them back into town and assembled the house. He also did a lot of trading of his sculptures to friends to help him in the electrical and plumbing and foundation work. Earl's big break came in 1929 when he met Gary Cooper. And this is quite interesting in that Earl made a model up of an old guy and a horse and sent it to Cooper just on speculation in the hopes that Cooper may buy it. And that's exactly what happened. Not only did he buy the model, he also sent my father money to buy an airplane ticket to come down to Hollywood and visit him, which Earl did. Gary Cooper also offered my father an opportunity to come to his ranch in little town of Craig, Montana, the Cascade Mountains, and set up a little studio in one of the cabins there, which Earl did. And he met many collectors through this experience. I believe it was through Cooper that Earl became acquainted with a man by the name of W.A. Clark III. Clark's parents were big art patrons of the 30 era, and they owned a huge gold mine in Clarksville, Arizona. Mr. Clark arranged for my father to have a showing at the Stendhal Art Gallery in Los Angeles about 1931. Earl, at this point, was not yet 20 years old. The show was a complete sellout and pretty much launched Earl's career, because shortly after that, he had a showing at the World's Fair in Chicago, which was a total sellout. And through that show, he met Marshall Field, the man of the department store chain by the same name. Mr. Field bought a number of my father's works and also offered him an opportunity to set a studio up at one of his stores in Chicago. Earl declined this because he preferred to live in small town of Great Falls rather than the hustle bustle of Chicago. My father was primarily a sculptor, but he also did a lot of watercolors of Indians, animals and people of the times. And towards the latter part of his career, he began oil painting and did a number of pack horses. I discovered these sketches, and it appears that at one point in Earl's career, he was trying to get an order for a beer advertisement. As you can see, they're quite indicative of the 30 era. In the mid 30s, Earl also did a number of pen and ink sketches that he had transferred into, or made into Christmas cards. And as you can see, he did the general Western theme of animals and the West at that period of time. My father also did quite a few dioramas during his career. For those that are not familiar with the term, it's a sculpture with an oil painting in the rear of it, usually encased in glass. For Con Kelly, the president of Anaconda Copper Company, he made one of a depicting a miner working the face of a tunnel. And through his acquaintances at the Montana Power Company, he obtained a order to do a diorama of Boulder Dam. It was done from an aerial photograph. In the mid-30s, Earl corresponded with Gutzon Borglum while he was working on a Mount Rushmore sculpture. And Borglum invited my father to come and visit the site, which he did. And Borglum allowed Earl to get up on the mountain and take these photographs. My father aspired to do large sculptures such as this, but Mr. Borglum convinced him that he would be better off doing what he was and making the small Western models. He would make preliminary pencil sketches of the model before he began the actual sculpturing, sort of idea sketches. His method of making models was by first making a wire armature, and the wire that he used was very stiff because it had to support the weight of the clay on a couple of legs. And to do this, there was considerable engineering involved, and many times to lighten the models so that when bend his wire armature, he would wrap cloth around the wire and then paper mache so that the bulk of the horse wouldn't be solid and therefore be lighter and stand on its own armature. He also used a lot of substances in the work other than clay. For instance, on the work he did of the dog sled, he used an actual hide off of a small animal for the skin on the polar bear. Many of his small parts on his sculptures were carved out of lead, such as guns and spurs and bits and so on. An interesting point I came across when I was making the mold of the right-of-way sculpture is that the grizzly bear, we couldn't take the mold off the teeth without having to cut the bottom jaw off. And in the process of doing this, I discovered that he had actually used the teeth from a small animal as the teeth in the grizzly bear. Earl also began making molds during his career. He made quite a number of these. The horse head mold I still have, as you can see, it was made with the old red rubber. He would sell these at Glacier Park and take them with him on his art shows and sell them for $5-$10 a piece. Besides being completely self-taught as a sculptor, he also made his own tools. He'd make out of wood or wire or whatever was handy at the time. This enabled him to do the fine detail, as you see on his works. It never ceases to amaze me the detail my father put in his sculptures. And in that I molded this piece, and we cast a number of bronze copies. In the process, they have to be taken apart. And I learned that, you know, little stirrups were made out of lead, and he'd use twine that he would braid into rope for all the ropes on him. The hat had a wire armature in it to hold it together. And his faces are quite indicative of the 30 era. He would generally, on these pack trains, he'd always put a whiskey bottle in the man's pocket. Evidently, he did a lot of drinking on the trail. His experience as a Glacier Park area as a hunting guide taught him how to do the diamond hitch, which he incorporated into his sculptures. The axe was actually lead handle, and he actually carved a little wooden handle for this piece. The little stove he folded up out of sheet metal, it appeared to be made out of a tin can. And the pack itself was actual cloth that he had put a solution on it that would stiffen it. And this is separate from the horse itself. And all the harnesses were made with leather that he would make little strips of. And the muscles are also detailed. His knowledge of anatomy is evident in viewing his sculptures. He spent quite a bit of time studying the anatomy of the horse and the human. Pack horses were generally the smaller of the species that were good for nothing else, so they used them for pack horses. In the mid-30s, they were still Indians living in teepees outside of Great Falls, which Earl would visit with them. This is a sculpture of a Blackfoot Indian titled The Pagan Scout, and has all the detail on it, the wampum beads.